Oh, good morning, protege. Of course, good afternoon to my wonderful and favorite eighth grade class. Hey, I hope this direct instructional Zoomcast finds you well. Wow, I can't believe I'm saying this. I think the very first Zoomcast I did, I recorded in my classroom, and I think it's only poetic justice, and I think it's only appropriate that my final official Zoomcast of the 2021-2022 school year would transpire in my classroom. All right, let's get into it, shall we? You guys know the drill at this point. So on your desk, you should have your assignment book out and open, folded over, filled out, of course, for May 20th. On your ISN, top right-hand corner, make certain right side of the next clean sheet of paper, make certain that you dated your notes for today. It is May 20th and it's Friday. So let me share my screen with everybody. And again, I want to remind everybody, and I understand and I get on your desk, you have your highlighters and your correctable tape, but I'm going to respectfully request that everybody refrain from using it until I have finished the Zoomcast. And after, of course, you're going to be taking an assessment during this class period. I'm a little surprised about this assessment, so you'll find out as I wrap up the Zoomcast. All right, so here's your job. So on the top line, I want everybody to write down for me the origins of the Vietnam War. If I had a little bit more time, another week or two, I could really get into a lot more depth in the Vietnam War. But I want to just give you guys a nice overview in terms of why the United States became involved in Vietnam, very similar to why the United States became involved in Korea, basically going back 15 years earlier. All right. And then also, time permitting, I want to talk about the role that certain American presidents played, kind of weaving this all together in America's involvement with the Vietnam War slash conflict. This is one of the similarities between, of course, the Vietnam War and the Korean War, in that Congress never officially declared war. So to dovetail back again, please refrain from using your, again, highlighters and correctable tape until the very end of the Zoomcast. All right, so here we go, if you would write this down. So the dealio is this. So we're going to look at initially the years 1941 through 1973. So we're looking at, again, a little over 30 years. Now, during that period of time, 1941, of course, the world was in the grips of World War II. And then 1973, pivotal year, I was going into sixth grade. And we will be witnessing, again, what's called the Watergate scandal. Another story, another topic for another time. The Vietnamese people are going to be involved at this point in three different wars. I'd like you to write this down. So war number one, Japan. So the Japanese had invaded, again, French Indochina, which, of course, Vietnam was part of. And the Vietnamese will be fighting the Japanese from 1941 through 1945. Now, remember, you have different countries that make up French Indochina. You have Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. Remember that. You might be asked that on your assessment coming up this morning or this afternoon for my eighth grade class. Then number two, there's a break in the action, short break. Then the Vietnamese people are going to fight a second war. Now, this time, they're not going to fight against the Japanese. This time, they're going to fight against the French. And this is going to be from 1946 through 1954. And this is called the first, again, Indochina War. Then we're going to take another break in the action. And then the Vietnamese people are going to be fighting against the United States of America, the most powerful country in the world. And this is going to be from 1965 through 1973, when the Paris Peace Accords were signed. And this is all, of course, called the Vietnam War. Technically, we should call it the Vietnam Conflict, because remember, Congress never officially declared war on Vietnam. President Johnson simply commits troops the way President Truman committed troops to Korea again in 1950. Now, in addition, if you would write this down, I think it's important to have some understanding about Vietnam and the Vietnam War, because not one, not two, not three, not four, but five different American presidents play a role in the molding and shaping of the Vietnam War. Generally, as a rule of thumb, there's one president in particular, two actually, I'd even go so far as to say, that you always associate their presidencies with Vietnam, especially one I can think of in particular. But there are three other presidents besides. So number one, yes, Harry Truman is one of the first presidents that is going to take an active interest in what is going on in Vietnam. That's number one. Number two, besides Harry Truman, Dwight David Eisenhower is going to really help mold and shape our policy in dealing with, of course, Vietnam. And if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, that of course, that's a portrait of our 34th president, Dwight David Eisenhower. Number three, we just learned about him, John F. Kennedy, JFK. JFK also is going to get America a little bit more involved in Vietnam. Again, not really committing troops per se, trying to provide assistance to the folks in South Vietnam. Again, Kennedy was having some reservations in his first and only term as president, how much involvement America should really participate in terms of Vietnam. Moving on, president number four, Lyndon Baines Johnson, arguably the greatest president when it comes to civil rights. You notice how I'm getting dovetailing back and working in information. So if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, I personally, whenever I think of Vietnam, I always think of Lyndon Baines Johnson. He's my number one choice because he's the president that truly committed American troops, I mean, really on a much larger scale, even far more so than John F. Kennedy. It was really Lyndon Baines Johnson. And ultimately, it was Lyndon Baines Johnson's commitment to Vietnam and the Vietnam War that ultimately led to his decision in 1968. He doesn't seek the presidency. He could have, but he chose not to. And then finally, number five, the last president that is involved with Vietnam is Richard Nixon. So remember, Richard Nixon, we first learned about with the Alger Hiss case when we had, again, the House Un-American Activities Committee was investigating, again, Alger Hiss. Was he actually spying for the Soviet Union? We know that Richard Nixon became the running mate, of course, of Dwight David Eisenhower and was vice president from 1953 until 1961. We also know that Richard Nixon barely lost John F. Kennedy in terms of the popular vote. The electoral vote wasn't that close. Richard Nixon lost the election of 1960, and then 8 years later, he runs for the presidency against Herbert Humphrey, and this time he ends up winning this election and then runs for re-election in 1972. Nixon is also the other prominent president besides Lyndon Baines Johnson. You should make an oral note off to the side. So Johnson was the president that gets America really involved in Vietnam. You should make that as a side bullet note or margin note. And it was Richard Nixon who gets America out of the Vietnam War 1973 through what's called the Paris Peace Accords. All right. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, when you look at our presidents, once again, to summarize, five different American presidents play a role in getting America involved in Vietnam. But it was, again, just to emphasize and to summarize, it's Lyndon Baines Johnson. Take a good look at this photograph. You're going to see him on your quiz coming up very soon, your progress check. He's the president that really, truly gets America much more actively involved with Vietnam, ultimately leads to Lyndon Baines Johnson's decision to not seek a re-election in 1968. And then, of course, Richard Nixon, the president who ultimately gets America out of Vietnam, Paris Peace Accords in 1973. All right. So if you would please write this down. So what I want to do is talk about, again, the road to America's involvement in Vietnam. I think in order to understand why we fought in Vietnam, starting in really in earnest in 1965, you really got to go back to the end of World War II and the beginning of what's called the French Indochina War. So the French, now that World War II is over, are going to focus on their colonies. And Vietnam was one of its colonies, part of French Indochina. So as the French were fighting to prevent the Vietnamese people from gaining their freedom and breaking away from, again, the colonial rule of France, a question is raised, and I want you to write this down. So when you look at, again, why the French were getting involved in fighting against the Vietnamese, and then ultimately why the United States is going to get involved with Vietnam, I think you have to ask yourself, it raises a question. Was this conflict between 1946 and 1954, again, the first French Indochina War, was it a conflict over imperialism? Write that down. We learned about imperialism back in World War I. See how I'm dovetailing back and weaving in information? That's what you do. So again, imperialism is when the big fish gobbles up the little fish, when big countries like France gobble up smaller countries like French Indochina, which eventually will become Laos, Cambodia, and of course, our country in focus, and that is Vietnam. Or was number two, was the focus of the French initially, but then the United States is going to get much more actively involved too. Was it really a fight for imperialism, or was this part of a much bigger fight, a much bigger global conflict? And of course, we know it as a Cold War. Remember, we're trying to stop the spread of communism through the influence of first the Soviet Union, and then of course, China. So the first president that takes an active interest in Vietnam is of course, Harry Truman. You should draw a line off to the side and mention that. Now, what Harry Truman's going to do is he sees the Vietnam, or this fight in Vietnam, the first French Indochina War, 1946 through 1954, former president Harry Truman is going to help provide military aid to the French. Now, in the case of why Truman is doing this, was it about saving France's colony in terms of imperialism? No, it was not about imperialism. It was to the French, it wasn't to the Americans. So first of all, number one, by 1950, President Truman, now remember, 1950 is a critical year because Truman not only commits troops to Korea, he's also committing assistance, military assistance to Vietnam, not to the Vietnamese people, to prevent them from gaining their independence. And because his fear was the spread of communism. So $10 million was earmarked to help the French stop the Vietnamese gain their freedom, because it really does tie in with this. And I would make a little side note. It ties in with the Cold War. Truman does not want to see communism spread to Southeast Asia, whether you're talking about Korea or now you're talking about Vietnam. So to give you an idea of how serious Truman was, 1 year later in 1951, the war was not going so well for the French. He's going to increase military aid to the French and trying to stop the Vietnamese people from gaining their independence up to $100 million. And this ultimately is part of what we call the Truman Doctrine. Yes. So remember, we learned about the Truman Doctrine in 1947, 3 years earlier, 4 years earlier. Initially, it was about Greece and of course, we learned about Turkey. But now, remember, $400 million to prop up those countries, it was very successful. It stopped the spread of communism. So now what Harry Truman's trying to do is stop the spread of communism throughout Southeast Asia. All right, so let's continue on. Now, I'm going to skip over this part. So I'd like you to write this down. So now we're going to shift gears, and now we're going to go to our second major American president, who again is going to take an active interest in the affairs of Vietnam. So it was first Harry Truman. Now it's 1954. Harry Truman is no longer president. The new kid on the block, of course, is our 34th president, Dwight David Eisenhower. And again, you see how I'm dovetailing back and I'm circling back the wagons and bringing back people that you'd say, well, why are we talking about them? We already did. No, the story doesn't end. It's just a new chapter. So in 1954, President Eisenhower is going to create this new foreign policy of dealing with Vietnam. And this policy is called the Domino Theory. So if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, those, of course, are dominoes. And you notice if you have your dominoes all lined up, if one domino falls, look what happens. They all come tumbling down. So this is the metaphor that they're using. So if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, I've given you kind of a clue what the domino theory is. So what I want you to do is I now want you to pause the Zoomcast for 2 to 3 minutes. Draw a line off to the side. And in one paragraph, I want you to write for me a reflection in one paragraph. Describe what you see in this political cartoon. And then in the same paragraph, you explain for me, based on the clue that I just gave you about dominoes, what is the domino theory of President Dwight David Eisenhower in terms of America's involvement in Vietnam? Take a look at this political cartoon. So again, pause the Zoomcast for approximately 3 minutes. Write me a good reflection. I'm going to be circling around the room. This makes sure everybody's doing this. And again, this is going to help you on the assessment coming up very soon. All right, let's continue on. If you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, here's another political cartoon. Also tying in with the previous political cartoon and the domino theory. So again, look at some of these dominoes. I see Eastern Europe, China, North Korea, North Vietnam, South Vietnam. Here's again, this is Uncle Sam representing the United States. He's holding up these dominoes. Why do you think he's propping them up? Because look what's over here, Cambodia, Laos, the rest of Southeast Asia. If one domino falls, then they all fall ultimately to communism, which is not in the best interest of the United States as we are still waging the Cold War. So yes, if you would write this down. So the whole point of the domino theory of President Eisenhower is America does need to take a more active interest in the affairs of Vietnam, because the fear is if Vietnam fell to communism, the way North Korea fell to communism, the way China fell to communism with the Chinese Red Revolution, the fear was the rest of Southeast Asia might fall under the spell of communism. Laos, Cambodia, potentially Thailand, Burma, which is now Myanmar, and yes, even Japan, which was greatly weakened and devastated after in the aftermath of World War II, there was a fear that Japan also could fall under the spell of communism. So this policy, if you would write this down, eventually paves the way for America's eventual much more on a much larger scale involvement in, of course, Vietnam. So it really starts initially with Harry Truman, and then we're going to just kind of continue on with the presidency of Dwight David Eisenhower. So the domino theory. And trust me, future presidents are also going to subscribe to this as well. All right. So we're going to now move on. So we're going to skip over this information. Let's go to this. I want to talk about the involvement of our next presidents. Now, before we do that, though, here's what I would like you to do. I'd like you, before we talk about the involvement of John F. Kennedy in Vietnam, I want you to skip a full page. I want you to go to the right side of the next clean sheet of paper. Make sure that you date your notes again for today. It is May 20th, 2022. I want everybody to write down for me video clip, the history of the Viet Cong. So before we get into the, again, President Kennedy's involvement in the affairs of the Vietnamese people, 1961 till his tragic assassination in 1963, you need to know something about the Viet Cong. They're going to become a big prominent player as America really becomes involved in the affairs of Vietnam, the ultimately Vietnam War, or again, more technically, more specific, the Vietnam conflict from 1965 to 1973. All right, so let me give you some guide questions. And this is a really powerful video. Great song that kind of sets the tone. You'll find out later. Number one, so who were the Viet Cong? You're going to find out they play a huge role in the scope and sequence and ultimately the outcome of the Vietnam War slash conflict. If you say war, I'm not going to certainly grade you down, but technically it was the Vietnam conflict because Congress never declared war. Number two, what were the goals of the Viet Cong? I'm going to go through these guide questions relatively quickly. Number three, what were their various nicknames? Next guide question, number four, this is important. What tactics did they use? Because ultimately, the North Vietnamese and the Viet Cong are going to be fighting the most powerful country in the world. And a little secret, I'm going to let the cat out of the bag. When the Paris Peace Accords were signed in 1973, history will tell you that the winner of the Vietnam War slash conflict was not the United States. In many ways, we lost this war because we may not have lost this war militarily, but strategically and militarily, or let me rephrase that, politically more so, we lost this war. We did not achieve our goals. So yes, history will tell you that the Vietnam War was not an American victory. It was a victory for North Vietnam. I want you to describe the training of the Viet Cong. All right, ladies and gentlemen, so here we go. We're going to get into my video clip. It's about 3 minutes long. And again, it's one of my favorite bands from the big hair 80s, Poison. And the song is called Give Me Something to Believe In, tying in with the Vietnam War and the Viet Cong. Here we go.
See him on the TV preaching about the promised lands. He
tells me believing Jesus steals the money from my hands. Some say he was a good man. Lord, I think he sinned. War on a foreign shore, the finest country didn't want him back. The boys took his best friends in Saigon. Our Lord took his wife, his kids, no regrets. Any time I don't remember, in a war he can't forget. He cried, forgive me for what I'd done there, 'cause I never meant the things I did.
So the bottom line is the North Vietnamese people, there's no way they could beat the United States on a full-scale battle or on a battlefield, like the way when we fought against the Nazis in World War II. And they knew that. They did not have the military capability. So what the North Vietnamese and the Viet Cong did was they took their strength and they accentuated it. And their strength was, A, their understanding of the land. That's first and foremost. They knew the land better than the Americans did. And then B, ironically, they used the same tactics that the colonists used to fight the Brits in the Southern colonies, Francis Marion and the Swamp Fox. And that's called guerrilla warfare. It's called hit and run. Hit your enemy when they least expect it, use the element of surprise. And when the enemy has a chance to respond, you depart. And you depart and you're able to escape because you know the land better than your opponent does. All right, let's continue on. I want you to go back to the previous set of notes. So here we go. So ladies and gentlemen, if you would write this down. So when John F. Kennedy, prior to being president and prior to being a senator from the great state of Massachusetts, so this is going back to the mid to late 1940s, early 1950s. So this is when Harry Truman was beginning to commit military aid to help the French in preventing, the Vietnamese people from getting their freedom, tying in with the Truman Doctrine, stopping the spread of communism. So initially, John F. Kennedy was not on board in America's involvement with Vietnam. And if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, that, of course, is a photograph of a young congressman from Massachusetts. And that, of course, is Jack Kennedy. We, of course, know him as JFK, John Kennedy. However, there's a bit of a change of heart if you would write this down. So by 1956, John Kennedy, of course, is now a senator from the great state of Massachusetts with an eye already looking towards the White House in a run for the presidency in 1960. So by 1956, John F. Kennedy has a change of heart. Was it politically motivated or was it something beyond that? You have to ask John F. Kennedy. He's not here to answer the question. But we do know that by 1956, John F. Kennedy was on board with, again, this policy that Dwight David Eisenhower had emphasized. And that, of course, is the Domino Theory, that if Vietnam potentially fell to communism, You run the risk of other countries in Southeast Asia falling, Laos, Cambodia, possibly Thailand. And yes, beyond Southeast Asia, the other fear was Japan might be been so weakened from fighting against the Americans in World War II, they also might be susceptible to again, the potential of communism taking over. So again, this is a political cartoon that I shared with you earlier. It's again, this is Uncle Sam, again, representing the United States, trying to prevent, again, the dominoes from falling and knocking over Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, the rest of Southeast Asia, and potentially Japan, all falling under the spell of communism. Let's continue on. So as a matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, it was John F. Kennedy as a senator in the late 1950s who was quoted as saying, and I quote John F. Kennedy, Senator Kennedy, excuse me, not president yet, quote, Vietnam is the cornerstone of a free world in Southeast Asia. So you can already see that the wheels are being set into motion for the United States, again, potentially getting involved in Vietnam on a much bigger scale. All right, if you would please write this down. So ladies and gentlemen, here's the story. Now, as president of the United States, so this is 1961, 1962, into November 21st, 1963. Remember, John F. Kennedy was tragically assassinated in Dallas, Texas. Now, as president, John F. Kennedy is in a bit of a quandary. A quandary is a very tough, challenging situation where it seems like there's no good way out. You know, you've got this option, and both options might be challenging. So number one, so when John F. Kennedy was president, his military advisors were recommending more economic aid and more military aid to South Vietnam. North Vietnam, just like North Korea, had been taken over by communism. And now the fear is that North Vietnam would invade South Vietnam, just the way North Korea had invaded South Korea and why America became involved. So it's almost like history is repeating itself all over again. Now, other advisors were telling Kennedy, we feel very strongly and passionately that we should have a complete withdrawal out of Vietnam, that they felt that Vietnam was a quagmire, that the United States would get sucked into this and there would be no way out. So John F. Kennedy, or President Kennedy, considered both options. So do we get more involved with Vietnam or less involved with Vietnam? And Kennedy's solution was really simple. More weapons, more military advisors, but we're not ready to commit troops yet. But that eventually is coming. So by 1962, by mid-62, and John F. Kennedy is again going into year one, into year two of his presidency, there were 9,000 American military advisors in South Vietnam there to train the South Vietnamese to protect against South Vietnam from being taken over by communism. And if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, this is a photograph. Some of these guys over here, these are Green Berets. These are military advisors who are training the South Vietnamese to fight against the North Vietnamese and the Viet Cong in this fight. It's really, the Vietnam War is part of a much bigger global conflict. It's part of what we call, of course, the Cold War. So finally, this will be the last topic I want to cover with you. So the last major president that I want to focus on is Lyndon Baines Johnson. So we learned about the role of Harry Truman. We learned about the role of Dwight David Eisenhower in Vietnam. We learned about John F. Kennedy's, again, change of heart about Vietnam and how as president, he's going to be committing more military advisors and more financial military aid, but he wasn't ready to commit troops quite yet. So ladies and gentlemen, if you would write this down. So after the assassination of John F. Kennedy and South Vietnam's leader, Ngo Dinh Diem, in 1963, Vietnam now is becoming President Johnson's potential quagmire. Now, again, when you look at the word quagmire, okay, and he's in a quandary, he also is in a tough situation. So if you direct your attention up to my laptop screen, that, of course, is a photograph of Lyndon Baines Johnson. So here's his quagmire. What I'd like you to do is I'd like you to draw a line off to the side, and I want you to take about 2 to 3 minutes, and I want you to describe for me this political cartoon. And what do you think a quagmire is? This is important in understanding the story, because the quandary that Lyndon Baines Johnson is in is whether or not the United States should accelerate our commitment to sending in more troops beyond military advisors, or do we just stay the route that John F. Kennedy did, which is just advisors and military aid? But John F. Kennedy had even talked about cutting it back even more so. But there were military advisors who were telling Lyndon Baines Johnson, just like they warned President Kennedy, be careful about getting involved in Vietnam, because this war could prove to be a quagmire. And ladies and gentlemen, if you direct your attention up to the laptop screen, quicksand is an example of a quagmire. That is a great clue in terms of how this is all going to shake out. Now, from again, as you write this down, Lyndon Baines Johnson is asking the question, do we really get involved? Is there a potential that this could become a quagmire of the United States of America? But on the other hand, the United States also realizes that they need to, again, look at this as part of a bigger global conflict. And that, of course, is the Vietnam War, which is part of the Cold War. So now the commitment of Lyndon Baines Johnson is communism must be stopped from spreading throughout all of Vietnam, because otherwise all these dominoes are going to come all tumbling down. So what's going to happen, ladies and gentlemen, is if you would direct your attention up to my laptop screen. So Lyndon Baines Johnson at this point is going to commit American troops starting first in 1964 and really accelerating in 1965. And it all ties in 1964, which is called the Gulf of Tonkin incident, in which an American ship was allegedly attacked by the North Vietnamese. So as a result, Lyndon Baines Johnson makes the decision to commit American troops to now fighting on a much larger scale in, of course, Vietnam itself.
My fellow Americans, as President and Commander-in-Chief, it is my duty to the American people to report that renewed hostile actions against United States ships on the high seas in the Gulf of Tonkin have today required me to order the military forces of the United States to take action in reply. The initial attack on the destroyer Maddox on August 2nd was repeated today by a number of hostile vessels attacking two U.S. destroyers with torpedoes. The destroyers and supporting aircraft acted at once on the orders I gave after the initial act of aggression. We believe at least two of the attacking boats were sunk.
So to summarize, as we're running late on time, so as a result of the Gulf of Tonkin incident of 1964, President Johnson is going to issue what's called the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution. So in 1965, the United States is now going to actively commit hundreds and thousands of American troops to South Vietnam to stop the spread of communism. So the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution of 1964 into 1965 basically allows President Johnson to bypass going to Congress, seeking that declaration of war, just the way Harry Truman was able to bypass Congress for the declaration of war against, again, North Korea, in getting involved with the Korean conflict. And as a result, now the United States is going to be actively involved in Vietnam. And so from 1965 until 1973, when the Paris Peace Accords are signed, the United States is going to wage a war to stop the spread of communism. So ladies and gentlemen, at this point in time, your job is to do this. You're going to pause the Zoomcast. I have a special surprise. You are now going to start your progress check. Your reward is, since part of the progress check covers today's notes, this is the only progress check this entire school year, you may consult your ISN. So you may use your ISN to help you in answering the questions on this progress check. You may not Google. I will be circulating around the room. Only your ISN is allowed to do so. This is going to be the first and only open note assessment. So at this point, I want everybody to pause the Zoomcast, work on the progress check, and if you have any additional time, submit your assessment after you proofread it, come back to the Zoomcast, okay? Thank you so much. So pause the Zoomcast. Good luck in your assessment. Now, for everybody else who's now come back to the Zoomcast, since I can continue on, at this point, I have to bid you a fond adieu. I wish I had more time to teach you more about the Vietnam War. I wish I could talk more about, for example, the My Lai Massacre that really starts to change the scope and sequence of America's involvement in Vietnam. With regards to, again, America's disillusionment about Vietnam. Vietnam was the first televised war. I remember as a kid watching some of the footage and being scared. That was my monster. I was petrified. I thought I was going to be fighting in Vietnam as a 10 or 11 year old kid. But unfortunately, again, we don't have enough time to go into it. But I wanted to at least introduce Vietnam to you. And I think, again, hopefully you have greater perspective. So finally, since this is my last Zoomcast, I would like to take this opportunity to thank every single one of you for this opportunity of mentoring you. This is my 32nd and final year here at Aptakissick Junior High. And it's a very special one because, again, I vividly remember when I started at AJHS in the summer of 1990. And as I wrap up my career in the summer, going into the summer now of 2022, I have nothing but wonderful fond memories, nothing but positive plaudits and positive things to say about this wonderful community and this wonderful school district. And I want to thank District 102 for giving me this opportunity of teaching at Aptakissick Junior High. I've spent more than half of my life in this school. So this school will always have a very special place in my heart. All of my proteges, whether I taught you in 1990, 91, or teaching you as the class of 2022. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart for allowing me the opportunity of mentoring you and maybe looking at history through a very different lens. So as I wrap up my Zoomcast today, no tears, only happiness. And as I always like to say, you know, the story may have ended today, but you know the saga will continue tomorrow. And the rest, as we say, everyone, is history. Peace out, everybody, for the final time. Thank you so much. And as always, please be well.